UML, Unified Modeling Language, and we are discussing activity diagrams. So this activity diagram is more than a flowchart. So if you know how to make flowchart, activity diagram will be quite easier for you. So this UML activity diagram, it helps us to visualize certain use case. So the use case which we make, how we visualize this and how we can detail use case, are going to more detail level. So this activity diagram is basically a behavioral diagram. So it will show the behavior, that is the flow of activities throughout the system. And these activity diagrams are employed to show or represent the flow of events also in business processes. So you can say flow of events also in business processes modeling. So they may be used to examine business processes in order to identify two things. First is flow, the other one is requirements. Here are the symbols which are generally used in the activity diagram. First is the start or initial node. Now here the class is going to be instantiated, or you can say the object will be instantiated here. And this is a round circle and all filled. And this is used to represent the starting point, or you can say the initial state of an activity. The start in the flowchart is exactly like this. Then we have the activity, because this is activity diagram. So we have activity. This is a round cornered rectangle. So this is activity or action state. And this is employed, or this is used to represent the activities of the process. Then we have action, certain action, and this action, these used to represent the executable sub areas of an activity. So you can mark the difference here. This is round cornered rectangle, here it's semi-circled corner, two corners. These are actions. Then we have flows, that is how the activity flow. And this is an arrow, this is called as a control flow, or edge also it's called as. And this is used to represent the flow of control from one action to another action. Then we have dashed line, this is the object flow or control edge. And this is used to represent the path of objects moving through the activity. Final one is, the end one is the final activity, or you can say activity final node. So we have a circle along with this inside circle, and this is all filled. Final node, flow final node, and this is like this. This is used to mark the end of a single control flow. So this is for single control flow. This is for the complete activity. Here are two which looks almost similar. This is a decision node and this is a merge node. So this is used to represent a conditional branch. For example, is it going to rain? You say yes, you go here. You say no, you go here. This is a diamond shape. And merge is that the results are coming. So you merge them and then you can forward it. So this is merge node, used to represent the merging of flows. And it has several inputs. I'm not saying that it is just two, it can be multiple, but output is only one. This is output, these are inputs. Fork means creation. So this is used to create or used to represent a flow that may have, this is a small rectangle, or you can say long width rectangle vertically. And this flow that may branch into multiple multiple parallel flows. So these are all the activities which are running simultaneously or parallel flowing. Then coming to merge, so they have to go and they have to merge also because they are multiple. So just we start from here. So multiple flows are coming, and flow, the fork is always, you know, combined with the merge. So now this activity merge, and it is one activity coming out. So this merge is used to represent a flow that may branch into two or more parallel flows we just saw. But here we are combining to form a single flow. Then we have this signal sending, this kind of arrow. So this is used to represent the action of sending a signal to an accepting activity, any activity it can be. And signal receipt means that the signal is received. So if you see, if I combine these two, it's like this. So this part is signal sending, and this part, I'm just saying that it is making a proper shape or rectangular shape. This is signal receipt. So if you take them apart, this is signal sending, this is signal receipt. Now it is always required to write a comment or note. So this note or comment is represented by this folded, a rectangle. So this is used to add certain metadata or relevant comment to elements. These are the different swim lanes. In swimming, we have different lanes. So an activity diagram can have a multiple, you can say, swim lanes. And these are also known as partitions. Say this is partition 1, this is partition 2, this is partition 3. So there can be multiple partitions also which are possible here. And these are used to represent a group of action carried out by different actors in a single thread. So if actor 1 is doing this, actor 2 is doing these two. So these are used to represent or group. So we are grouping these two because this is carried out by an actor 2 in a single thread. So how, what you should follow or what you can do for these swim lanes, what you need to understand about. So this is, first is add swim lanes to linear processes. First is add swim lanes to the linear processes, that will make it easier to read. And more than 5 swim lanes are not generally accepted or not considered as a good idea. And arrange swim lanes in a logical manner, right? So how to proceed with the activity diagram? So as I said, activity diagram can be used to model business requirement for your software, for your application, and we are creating high level view of the functionality, system functionality. So here functionality is coming, that is why we call them as activity. We analyze the use cases, and in each case we'll see how to draw an activity diagram from the beginning, that is figure out the action steps from the use case. So if you have made a use case from here, because use case is a very, it's just a scenario, and from there you can start the activity. So we have to identify different activities and actions the business process or a system is made up of. The second thing is identify the actors who are involved here. If you already figured out the actors, then it's quite easier to discern or follow each action they are responsible for. Then you have to find a flow among these activities, which should come after which. Means we have to mark down the condition that have to be met in order to carry out certain processes. And which action occur at the same time, that is like this. Or, you need to add any branches in the diagram. And do you have complete some actions before you have to proceed for others? Do you want to complete the sum of them so the other can proceed? And finally, you can add the swim lanes. And if you have really figured out who is responsible for each action, so the time is to assign them to a swim lane. And now group them. Or group each action, they are responsible for writing or presenting them below each of the defined activity. So here is an ATM system for certain bank. It's quite a very easy or simple example, and let me just show you and then I'll discuss this. This is the account holder, ATM, book server, or you can say the background bank, you can also say, or you can say just server. So what does the account holder activity follows, and what activity of account holder are related with the ATM machine and the server? How does this go and what do these means? Let me just go through this. So first thing first is we have an account holder. So we have identified that for an ATM system, there has to be an account holder, and this was our actor in our use case diagram. Then the ATM was also there, and finally the server or bank server. First thing is what? As I said, first thing is to start. So you start from here, and everything, the flow of control is shown by the arrow. So this is the arrow. What will be the account holder doing? What will he do? He will insert the card. So this is the inserting of card. When he inserts the card, what will happen? He has to enter the PIN. So after entering the PIN, what will happen? The verification of PIN has to go. So account holder cannot verify. ATM is just a front end. So there has to be some background processing going on, and which we call that it is a server. So here verifying of PIN will be done. So enter PIN will give rise to verify PIN, and this will come under this server. Once the verification is done, either the PIN is correct or PIN name may not be correct. So what will happen? If the PIN is valid, then the different options are presented to the account holder. One of them can be enter withdrawal amount. Now what will happen if there is an invalid PIN? If the PIN is invalid, then it will be insufficient fund, or means I'll just tell you that this one will run for two activities. One is if the PIN is invalid, and if the user enters an amount, the server will verify the amount, and then again certain situation arises. Either the amount, say he has say $5,000 and he wants some $6,000, so he won't be able to make this transaction. So insufficient fund and invalid PIN will go to server to deal with. But if the conditions are good, that is, if the PIN is valid and the sufficient funds are there, that is, he wants say $4,000, then he will take out the funds. Will take out the fund. And if the PIN is invalid or the funds are insufficient, then they will go, because this activity and this activity can go to a single final decision. He will take fund, and he can also, when he take fund, so if I take say $4,000 from $5,000, what should happen? This should be deducted. So my account should show $1,000 only. So I have to do a remove funds from account, and this is the background activity which the server has to do simultaneously. If the funds are taken, this remove from funds have to be done here. Then this, it has taken fund, and the removal of funds from the account has taken place. Now we go down to this, as I said, merge and fork, I told you. So this is kind of merging. This is also merge. So this is logging out your session. The card will be ejected, and finally you take out your card. And this ATM is doing what? It is logging out session and ejecting the card. And this is not done by the server. The server is doing some other task. But the ATM as a front end is actually logging out your session, or ejecting your card. Server is not doing that. Server is only doing this, and when the ATM gets an information, okay, the funds have been taken and the removal of funds deduction has been done, then the logging out of session will take place. Finally, the ejection of card and take card, but we still have here, see, if they are insufficient fund or if they are invalid. So just combine them and it will go to again the this one. You would have done like this also. This arrow, like this also. You would have done like this also. Or this way, doesn't matter. But this is the better way, that you have three merges here. Finally, taking out card and this ends. So this is just a simple ATM system for some bank. So this was about activity diagram. Thank you so much. Take care of yourself.